Morning. Let's stand as we read God's word. Psalm 30, 4 through 5 says, "Sing to the Lord, all you godly ones. Praise his holy name. For his anger lasts only a moment, but his favor lasts a lifetime. Weeping may last through the night, but joy comes in the morning."
Amen. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for meeting with us this morning as we gather to worship. Lord, we just ask that you'd help us to set aside everything that we might see you, hear you, just bask in your presence. For we do pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Give thanks to the Lord our God and King. His love endures forever.
Give thanks to the Lord our God and King. His love endures forever. For he is good, he is above all things. See?
The message of the cross is the power of God. 1 Corinthians 1:18. At the cross. Kids up here doing hand motions. Yeah, I was looking back there. Papa's doing hand motions. He's rolling them away here. He's just, yeah, having a good old time singing that wonderful song.
Holiness, holiness is what I long for. Holiness is what I need.
Transform.
Come into your presence and we praise your holy name. You alone are worthy of our praise and our adoration. And Lord, we come before you and you alone. We thank you. We thank you for your love, for your grace, for your mercy. We thank you for your forgiveness, your faithfulness, your holiness, your righteousness, as we have just sung about. And those qualities, Lord, that you are all a part of, and they just, that's who you are. You desire us to have those same kinds of qualities, and they're only available by your grace and through Jesus Christ, who gave his life for us, paid the price for our wrongs and for our sins, so that we might have life and might have it to the full here and now and on into eternity. Father, as we just come before you, we carry burdens upon our hearts, and we just place them before you. Place them on the altar of prayer right now. And each and every one of us have some concerns, I know, Lord, that we just lift up to you. And right now we just pause to do that very thing. As each one in the room just prays silently for their request, for their burden, Lord, we lift them to you. And Father, we still and continue to lift up the Maybe family and the Flowers family. As, Lord, one of our loved ones has entered into your presence, she is rejoicing. We are grieving, but yet we rejoice because she is free. Free from the pain and the suffering that she endured over the last couple of years. What a witness, what a testimony Amy has been and will continue to be to the family and to her friends. Lord, now as we just come before you and open your word together, we know you have a message for us. We know you have a word, a specific word for each and every one that is gathered here and each and every one that will watch this service and is watching right now. A word of comfort, a word of encouragement, a word of challenge. So God, we just give you the praise, we give you the honor, and we ask you to help us to listen to that word and to put it into practice in our lives. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Amen. You may be seated. Simply want to remind you that we do have an offering plate in the back for your tithes and offerings. Obviously, you can use Givelify. Someone is asking me this morning for the church's internet. Password for the internet here at the church, so that they could use Givelify, the Givelify app, and give that way. So that's always a possibility. So I'll let you do that. We have containers in the back to take up our Dime a Day missions on the mark. They're already. Kids would like to go to the back and get their containers. All the monies that are received do go to support our missions in Honduras. Solomon and Anita and their ministry with Omori Faye, Love and Faith Ministries. Thank you. Well, this is the first Sunday of the month of May, May 1, which means that we recognize our May birthdays. Oh, she's here. She's been looking at me back there. Any other May birthdays? Anyone have a birthday in the month of May? Come on up, Miss Patty and Miss Jessica. Any other May birthdays? Well, let's sing happy birthday to these folks. Do you like a blue or a black? You're not supposed to ask women how old they are.
Now I'm 39.
Oh, she's 39.
40.
40. And Miss Patty's not going to tell us. She's leaving. I think Miss Patty's 29. I'm not sure. Do we have any May anniversaries? May anniversaries. Come on up, those who have a May anniversary. Come on up here onto the stage so we can see you. Let's sing happy anniversary to these folks. Start here with the young folks. How many years?
No, five.
5 years. Oh, I should have asked you, do you want a blue one or a black one?
It's all right.
That's all right. And Mama and Papa, how many years?
73.
73 years. On May 27. May 27. Would you like a blue or a black? Mm-hmm. Oh, she'll take a blue. Their anniversary is May 20, and then theirs is May 27. 5 years and 70 many years.
Okay,
all right. And if you're wondering, they're both 91 years old. So if you do the math, they got married when they were 18. Right after my mother's high school graduation. I mean, literally right after my mother's high school graduation. They went from the graduation ceremony to the church and got married. Same night, same day, same night. Because my dad promised my grandmother, my mother's, that he would not marry her until she graduated high school. And so as soon as she had graduated, they got married. Children are dismissed to go to junior church at this time. I haven't done this in a long time, but I have quite a bit of scripture to read this morning, so I thought I would put it on slides. That way, if, in case you don't have a Bible or you don't have a Bible app on your phone readily available, which is the way I would rather you follow along, you can follow along with some slides that I'm going to have appear. We're all about being intentional. This is the second Sunday in a series on being intentional. You say, well, what in the world does that mean? It means living on purpose. It means living with an intention in your life, having a plan, working towards a goal. It's all about being intentional. Now, a lot of people, even in the business world, talk about being intentional in their life. In fact, if you go to life coaches, that's what they're going to tell you, be intentional, just seize the day kind of thing. But I'm going to submit to you, and I am submitting to you, that you cannot be intentional in your life's plan until Jesus Christ is the center of your life. And so that's what this morning's message is going to be all about, having Jesus the center, making Christ the center of your life. See what I did with center there? I put it in the center. Yeah, okay. I just wanted to make sure you got the little connection there. Be intentional, making Christ the center of your life. If we were to say number one point, it is this: Jesus is to be our focus. That's how we make him the center of our life. Make Jesus the focus. The scripture that I'd like to share with you, and I'm going to see if I can do this from here. Oh, I didn't think I could. That's okay. I can come down here. Oh, I love it when technology works, don't you? Okay, let's go and start over. It's really going to be worth it, believe me. All right, Colossians. Colossians 1:15 through 18. 1:15 through 18. Okay, follow along. Christ, this is Paul writing to the Colossian church, right, in the letter of Colossians. Christ is the visible image of the invisible God. He existed before anything was created and is supreme over all creation. That's Christ, right? For through him, God created everything in the heavenly realms and on earth. He made the things we can see and the things we can't see, such as thrones, kingdoms, rulers, and authorities in the unseen world. Everything was created through him and for him. He existed before anything else, and he holds all creation together. Christ is also the head of the church, which is his body. He is the beginning, supreme over all who rise from the dead, so he is first in everything. Oops, wrong way. For Christ, verse 19, for God in his fullness was pleased to live in Christ, and through him God reconciled everything to himself. He made peace with everything in heaven and on earth by means of Christ's blood on the cross. This includes you who were once far away from God. You know how he can say that? Because all of us at one time or another are far away from God. So when he says you, he's talking to you. You were once far away from God. You, oh, we don't like to hear this next part. You were his enemies, separated from him by your own evil thoughts and actions. Yet now he has reconciled you to himself through the death of Jesus, through Christ, rather, in his physical body. As a result, he has brought you into his own presence, and you are holy and blameless as you stand before him without a single fault. That's why we can sing holiness, holiness. That's what we desire. That's what we need. That's what God wants from us, right? But you must continue, verse 23, but you must continue to believe this truth and stand firmly in it. Don't drift away from the assurance that you received when you heard the good news. The good news has been preached all over the world, and I, Paul, have been appointed as God's servant to proclaim it. Isn't that a great passage of scripture? I mean, that is just awesome because it tells us where Christ fits in the universe. And not just in the universe, that he created the universe. It was through him that all things are created. He's the one that, and it was created for him. He is supreme. You know, I've preached a sermon series on Colossians before, and you could just use one word to describe all of Colossians, and you could just preach it, and I could say this one name for 20 minutes long, and that could be my sermon, because that was what summarizes Colossians, and it is Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Jesus. Is he your focus? In order for him to be the center of your life, it needs to be your focus. From the very beginning, Jesus is the supreme focus of the Bible. Did you get that? From the very beginning, from the third chapter in Genesis to the last chapter of Revelation, God reveals his plan to bring a Redeemer who's not only going to forgive our sins and offer us salvation, but is going to rule over all of creation. And that's what this passage is all about. Now, question. It's a rhetorical one. If the main focus of the Word of God, the Bible, is Jesus, then maybe isn't it a good idea that we make him our main focus? I mean, if the Word of God makes it is the main focus, Jesus, then shouldn't he be ours? Shouldn't he be the focus of our work life? Doing our work in a way that honors God and reflects biblical principles and integrity, no favoritism, helping to develop this focus of Jesus, church, then we're not allowing the focus of Christ into our marriage. Are we raising our children to love God and his word? Raising them to see God in the Bible is not just some distraction from daily hustle and bustle of life, but as the center of life. Jesus should be the focus. He should be the focus of our recreation, our entertainment. He should be the focus of our music and our movies and our books and our magazines and our surfing the web habits. Jesus should be the focus. Do these God-honoring, God-displaying, Jesus-focused things describe your life? Jesus should be the focus. Also, Jesus should be the boss. Jesus should be the boss. John 8, 31 through 32. Jesus said to the people who believed in him, "You are truly my disciples if," I need that word capitalized and enlarged in font, "if you remain faithful to my teachings, and you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." Now, as we're pretty familiar with that second part. The second part of that verse finds its way into our secular world and into our secular thinking, and even into, you know, in TV shows and movies. I'll hear this verse from time to time, and I'm thinking, I wonder if they know where that came from. I wonder if they know that Jesus is the one who said it. So we understand that second part, but what about the first part of this? What about verse 31 that leads into the context of what Jesus said here? If he says, "You are truly my disciples if you remain faithful to my teachings." Is Jesus the boss? Is Jesus the boss? See, if you claim to be a follower of Christ, a Christian, then you should be holding on to his teachings. Not just believing them, but obeying them. Jesus' teachings are incredibly practical and easy to understand when it comes to relationships and to other people, business ethics, etc. They're there. They're easy to read, sometimes not so easy to follow. But if you want a great place to start, you may be asking, so where do I find these teachings of Jesus? Sermon on the Mount would be a great place to start. You know, blessed are the meek, blessed are the peacemakers, blessed are the pure heart. Matthew chapter 5, the first of Jesus's teachings on the Sermon on the Mount, known as the Beatitudes, because of they're the blessed are you. It's a great place to start. Last week I mentioned that Jesus should run the show in your life for no other reason but because he created you. He owns you. You say, he don't own me. Yeah, he does. You're his. He created you. He has the right to tell you how to run your life. Are you letting him? Are you letting him? According to the Gallup poll, the evidence seems to indicate that there are no clear behavioral patterns that distinguish Christians from non-Christians in our society. We all seem to be marching to the same drummer, looking to the same shifting standards for contemporary culture for the basis of what's accepted behavior. Now, that's really kind of a sad statistic. It tells me that there's a lot of Christians, but few disciples. If you are truly my disciples, you will follow my teachings. Gordon Dahl has said, most middle-class Americans tend to worship their work at their play, and play at their worship. That's like us telling God that we know what's best. That it would be like us telling God that we know that it's best for me to be a dog instead of a human. God, you messed up. You should have created me. No, we can't tell God that. God knows what's right. God knows he is the boss. So is he our boss? You know, however you want to say that, the boss, he should be the king, our Lord. Those are all terms in which we use. And the Christian ones are lordship and king. But man, you know, get it down to where we are, the boss, the head honcho, the CEO, the one who is ultimately in charge. He is the boss. If I could go the right way, right? Galatians 2:20 says, my old self has been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. So I live in this earthly body by trusting in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. This tells me that Jesus is my source. He is to be my source. He is to be the one that I go to for everything in life. Jesus makes life possible. He didn't just create it, but he sustains it. He is the source of life. This verse tells us that if we call ourselves Christians, that we are no longer alive, but it is Christ who lives in us. The old self is gone, the new self has come through Christ. And he is the one that sustains us. And the life that we now live, we live by faith in him. We exercise faith when we obey, going back to the last point, right? Obey his word, trusting that all that he promises us, he gives us all that we have. So we give back to him what? At least a tenth of our income. Why? Because he's the one that gave it to us in the first place. It's his to begin with. So when he says tithe, give back to him, you realize that a tithe, the 10% of our income, is an Old Testament standard, whereas the New Testament standard is everything. We give to him 100%. Huh? So 10% doesn't seem so bad then, after all. We give to him. And you say, well, why do I tithe to the church? Why should I give? Because that is what sustains the ministry of the church. It makes us available for us to meet here and to be comfortable meeting together and worshiping together. But it also fuels us so that we can be inspired to go from this place to make disciples, to be disciples that are making disciples. You ever heard the terms love God, love people, make disciples? But Jesus is also a source of our significance and our security. He's not only one who grants us the ability to gain our resources and to be able to give back to Him through ministry, but He is also the one who sustains and is the source of our significance, who we are. We're important not because of who we are, but because of who He is. Remember the song, Who Am I, that I read last week? Who Am I, the Casting Crown song? Who am I? I'm not important because of who I am, because of what He's done, not because of what I've done, but because of who He is. It's not about me. Oh, I'm jumping ahead. That's my last point. It's about God. It's about God. What I mean is Jesus would have... Let this point sink in. God loves you so much that He would have sent Jesus to die if you were the only one that needed to be saved. God loves you that much. Now we get all tied up with this. God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. God gave Jesus for you. Is He the center of your life? Sounds like you're kind of important to Him. I'm not going to say you're the center of His life, but, you know. John 10:10. The thief's purpose, the thief in this case is Satan, the enemy, the devil. The thief's purpose is to steal, kill, and destroy. That's what he wants to do to our life. That's what he wants to do to our resources. That's what he wants to do to our plans, to our significance, to our security. The thief, the enemy, wants to steal, kill, and destroy. My purpose, Jesus says, is to give them, us, a rich and satisfying life. One translation says a full and abundant life, and a life in which that you might live abundantly, filled with abundance, satisfying significance, and security. Came across this. This is kind of funny. Evangelist Billy Sunday. If you don't know who Billy Sunday is, Google him. Billy Sunday, great evangelist from way back. I guess the end of the 19th century, first part of the 20th century. Okay, Billy Sunday. Once said that some people use... I couldn't help but think of this because I knew I was going to get to this. When we were singing the song At the Cross, you know what are the last words to the... to the chorus of At the Cross. The last phrase of the chorus At the Cross. You sang it a while ago. At the cross. What's the last phrase? That's not the last one. It's getting close. And now I am happy all the day. And now I am happy all the day. And I couldn't help but look out to your faces when we sang that and see... Now I am happy all the day. Some of you, not all of you. Not my dad. He's back there doing motions, hand motions like Selena was saying. And now I am happy all the... Are you happy all the day? Okay, Billy Sunday once said, that to see some people, you would think that the essential quality of Orthodox Christianity is to have a face so long that you could eat oatmeal at the end of a gas pipe. I'm thinking, what does that mean? I don't even know what that means. But I Googled it to try to find out a little bit about what that meant. And it means, you know, having a long face, it means to look sad and dissatisfied. And it was a very typical phrase of the 19th century. Why do you have such a long face? Now, why are you so sad? Why are you so dissatisfied with what's going on? Now, why do you have such a long face? And so a gloomy Christian is a contradictory of terms. A gloomy Christian, a contradictory of terms, an oxymoron, if you will, right? Nothing in all religious history has done Christianity more harm than to think that we have to be wearing black clothes and have long faces in order to worship God. We're celebrating Christians. We need to bring that song back, right? We're celebrating Christians. There should be joy in our lives. Why? Because Jesus is our source of everything, including joy. So why are we so downcast? Came across this little story. Yeah, we'll go there. I'm probably not even going. I still don't know which way to go, up and down. Someone needs to teach me this. I came across this story. A cheerful girl with bouncy golden curls was almost 5. With her mother at the checkout stand, she saw a circle of glistening white pearls in a pink foil box. Oh, please, Mommy, can I have them? Please, Mommy, can I have them? Quickly, the mom checked the back of the little foil box and looked into the pleading blue eyes of her little girl, and she said, $1.95. That's almost $2. If you really want them, I think that some extra chores need to be done, and by no time you'll have saved up enough money so that you can buy them yourself. Your birthday's only a week away, and you might even get another crisp $1 bill. Maybe this was written a long time ago, inflation. No. Crisp $1 bill from Grandma. As soon as Jenny got home, she emptied her penny bank and counted out 17 pennies. After dinner, she did more than her share of chores, and she went to the neighbor and asked her neighbor if she could pick dandelions out of the yard for 10 cents. And on her way to her birthday, her mom gave her another new dollar bill. And so finally, she had enough money to buy this little pearl necklace, $1.95, $2. Wow, Jenny loved these pearls. They made her feel so dressed up, so grown up. She wore them everywhere she went. She wore them to Sunday school. She wore them to kindergarten. She even wore them to bed. The only time that she took them off is when she went swimming or had a bubble bath. Mother said if they got wet, they may turn her neck green. So she didn't wear them then. Jenny had a very loving father, and every night when she was ready for bed, he would stop whatever he was doing and come upstairs and read her a story. One night when he finished the story, he asked Jenny, "Do you love me?" "Oh, yes, Daddy, you know I love you." "Then give me your pearls." "Oh, Daddy, not my pearls, but you can have my princess. You can have my white horse of my collection. You can have the one with the pink tail. Remember, Daddy? The one that you gave me, she's my favorite. You can have her." "That's okay, honey," Daddy says. "I love you. Good night." And he brushed her cheek with a kiss. About a week later, after story time, Jenny's daddy asked, "Do you love me?" "Daddy, you know that I love you." "Then give me your pearls." "Oh, Daddy, not my pearls. But you can have my baby doll, you know, the brand new one that I got for my birthday. She's so beautiful and has this little yellow blanket that matches her sleeper." "That's okay, Jenny. Sleep well. God bless you. Daddy loves you." And he'd brush her cheek with a kiss. A few nights later, her daddy came in. Jenny was sitting on her bed with her legs crossed Indian style. And as he came close, she noticed her chin was trembling and a little tear coming down her face. "What is it, Jenny? What's the matter?" Jenny didn't say anything but lifted up her little hand to her daddy. And when she opened it, there was her pearl necklace. With a quiver, she finally said, "Here, Daddy, it's for you." With tears gathering in his own eyes, Jenny's kind daddy reached out one hand to take the dime store necklace and with the other hand reached in his pocket and pulled out a blue velvet case with a strand of genuine pearls, and he gave it to Jenny. He had had them all the time. He was just waiting for her to give up the dime store stuff so that she could have her genuine treasure. You know, it's the same way with our Heavenly Father. What are we hanging on to that He keeps asking us for? Let Him give you the genuine article of a full and satisfying life instead of the cheap dime store imitation that we seem so hard to cling on to. It's true that you may have to give up some activities. I'm not going to sugarcoat that. But you can rest assured if the Bible says don't do it, it's because it's harmful to you or to others, either physically or spiritually in some way. Surrender yourself to Christ and experience the wonderful, full life that He has for you. Jesus is the source. Make Him the center of your life. The next time you want to make it about anything other than Christ, remember this. Here's the bottom line. It's not about you. Sorry. No, not sorry. It's not about you. Your life is not about you. Your life is about bringing glory and honor to the one who created you. It's all about God. So everything we do in life should be about God. Jesus should be the center of our life. So let's by intent be intentional about making Jesus the center of our life. He should have the right place, right in the middle. Colossians 1:16b says, everything, and then the message, everything got started in Him and finds its purpose in Him. Same thing for your life. Don't hold on to the cheap imitation of whatever it is that you have and that you're holding on to in this life. Give it up and receive the rich, satisfying, full, abundant joy, not long-faced life that God has for you. He has a plan for you, and He wants you right in the middle of it. Right in the middle of it. Have you decided to follow Jesus? Are you following Jesus? If not, today's the day. Today's the day that you can begin to make Jesus the center of your life. And when you do, everything else falls into place. I love that verse it's in the Sermon on the Mount, by the way. Matthew 6:33. Seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. I paraphrase that. My own paraphrase says, put God first. Make Him number one priority. Put Jesus as the center of your life, and everything else in your life will fall into place. Or at least it will be the purpose of that, whatever is happening in your life, will be made known. Now, I'm not saying that you're going to know why you're going through the circumstances that you are, why you have the suffering and the and the hardships that you have from time to time. I don't know why. All I know is that we're told that we should praise Him in the middle of the storm. Praise Him in the storm. Praise Him when your niece, 46 years old, dies. We don't know why. We would say, man, she has so much more. I mean, she still had another 46 years that she could have lived. But her legacy's not gone. It continues through all the lives she touched. Wish you could have been there in this little Baptist church that holds about 250 people. There was probably 300 there. Standing room only. I was the one who had the beginning welcome and the opening prayer. And so I'm standing there saying, okay, there's three rows here up in the choir loft. If you don't want to stand in the back, feel free to come on up here and sit in the choir loft. We're not going to make you sing or anything, you know, just come on up. And so we had the choir loft filled with people. Talina and I sat up there. Finally had to say, okay, if you're comfortable with being in this church, you know, if you're a church member here and you feel comfortable in this church, come on up. You be some of the ones that take the place up here so that, and I know it's a rabbit trail. Is Jesus the center of your life? It was for Amy. And she would want you to make Christ the center of your life. You know what song we sang yesterday to close out the service? After the altar call, I have decided to follow Jesus. And as we were singing that, I told Talina, we're singing that tomorrow at the close of our service. Because it's all about making Christ the center of your life. So let's stand together. And before we sing, let me just ask you to bow your heads. Close your eyes. And if you have not ever asked Jesus Christ to come into your life, I invite you to do so right now. And it's real simple. I mean, the prayer is simple. Living the life afterwards may not be quite as easy, but it's worth it. The prayer is simple. It's just an ABC prayer. Admit that you have done wrong things and that you're sorry for them. Believe that Jesus Christ died on the cross to pay the penalty for the things that you have done wrong. So admit that you're wrong. Believe Jesus died to pay the penalty that you deserve to pay because of those wrongs. And confess Him as your Lord. And the Bible tells us that if we will admit that we're sinners, believe that Jesus died in our place, and confess Him as our Lord, then we will be saved. Can you pray that prayer right now? Pray that prayer right now, right where you are. Lord, I admit that I've done wrong things. I believe that Jesus died for me. And I confess that I want to make Him the center of my life, my Lord, my boss, the source of all that I do, the focus of everything I am, and decide now to follow Jesus. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
I have decided to follow Jesus.
come before you praising your name, and we just thank you for your grace, for your mercy. We thank you for Jesus. And so as we leave this place, may we all commit to making Jesus the center of our life, making him our focus, making him our boss, making him our source in all that we are and all that we do. We give you the praise. We give you the honor. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen and amen. God bless you.